in this video, I will explain what the mark of the beast is all about, because the God of heaven revealed the mark to King Solomon, who in turn wrote down the details for us. I will also state from the onset that the mark of the beast is not the COVID-19 vaccine or a computer chip placed under the skin of people's foreheads or right hands, as some people believe. I say this with confidence because in the entire Bible, there is not even one verse which links a vaccine or a chip to the mark of the beast. For those who have watched some of my videos, you have heard me say several times that the Song of Solomon reveals incredible end-time events hidden in the romantic language of the song. Among those mysteries is the mark of the beast, as I will explain shortly. I will begin by quoting the passage which the merciful God used to reveal the details of the mark to me. Song of Songs 1 verse 14, and I read, "My beloved is to me a cluster of henna blossoms from the vineyards of Engedi." Like most Christians who have attempted to understand the Song of Songs, when I first read the scripture above, I imagined a woman who is deeply in love with her man, whom she lovingly describes as a cluster of henna flowers obtained from the vineyards of a place called Engedi, which is located in Israel. But being a believer who understands that God does not use words as carelessly as human beings do, I asked myself why the God of heaven would compare a woman's lover to a cluster of henna flowers. I knew that there was something deep that God was trying to communicate to his people through that verse, something related to the end times, since I knew that the Song of Songs is an end time book disguised as a love story. Therefore, I kept digging and asking God for wisdom until the Lord opened my eyes so I could understand his warning message for the Christians embedded inside the scripture. What I mean is that the mark of the beast is related to the cluster of henna blossoms, as I will explain later in this video. But first, I will quote from Wikipedia, where we find interesting information concerning the substance known as henna. I read, "Henna is a dye prepared from the plant Lawsonia inemis, also known as the henna tree, the mignonette tree, and the Egyptian privet. Henna can also refer to the temporary body art resulting from the staining of the skin from the dyes. After henna stains reach their peak color, they hold for a few days, then gradually wear off by way of exfoliation, typically within 1 to 3 weeks. Henna has been used since antiquity in ancient Egypt to dye skin, hair, and fingernails. Henna stains are orange when the paste is first removed, but darken over the following 3 days to a deep reddish brown due to oxidation." End of quotation. There are 4 main points to be noted from the Wikipedia quotation, which I have summarized as follows. 1. Henna is a dye prepared from a tree which originated in Egypt and which was used to dye skin, hair, and fingernails. 2. Henna also refers to a temporal body art resulting from staining the skin with henna dye, which immediately reminded me of tattoos. 3. Henna stains are orange when the henna paste is first removed from the skin, but the stains darken over 3 days to become a deep reddish-brown color due to oxidation. 4. The henna stains or tattoos remain on the skin for up to 3 weeks, then they gradually wear off through a process called exfoliation, which is the removal of dead skin cells from the surface of the skin. Armed with the above information, I will now return to the Song of Songs, where I will quote 2 passages that will help me to reveal what I discovered concerning the beloved man who is likened to one cluster of henna blossoms out of an entire vineyard of Engedi. This is the same beloved who is said to be dazzling and reddish or ruddy in complexion, and who is outstanding among 10,000 other clusters, as the second verse below indicates. Song of Songs 1 verse 14, and I read, "My beloved is to me a cluster of henna blossoms from the vineyards of Engedi." Song of Songs 5 verse 10, and I read, "My beloved is dazzling and reddish, outstanding among 10,000. For those who like things short and sweet, I will immediately reveal the mark of the beast to you. I will begin by reminding you that before the serpent deceived Eve, the Bible tells us that the devil or ancient serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals that the Lord God had made." Genesis 3 verse 1. What I mean is that while people are expecting the devil to come along with something as advanced as a microchip placed under the skin to facilitate buying and selling, the devil will not be that obvious. Instead, he will use a much more crafty process to have his name or number marked on people's bodies, as I will soon explain. The name or number of the beast will be embedded inside the henna cluster that will be drawn on the right hand or on the forehead of every person so they can buy or sell in those days. For your convenience, I have attached a picture of a typical henna tattoo to show what will be drawn on people's hands in those days. The reason why the mark of the beast was revealed to King Solomon is because he was the wisest man who has ever walked on this earth, second only to the Lord Jesus. Because of his great wisdom, God gave Solomon an understanding of plant life that was not given to any other mortal, thereby enabling Solomon to understand the mysteries of the henna tree and all other trees, as the next passage explains. 1 Kings 4 verses 28 to 33, and I read, "God gave Solomon wisdom and very great insight and a breadth of understanding as measureless as the sand on the seashore. Solomon's wisdom was greater than the wisdom of all the people of the East, and greater than all the wisdom of Egypt. He spoke 3,000 proverbs, and his songs numbered 1,005. He spoke about plant life, from the cedar of Lebanon to the hyssop that grows out of walls." The book of Revelation also indicates that identifying the mark of the beast requires the possession of wisdom, the type of wisdom that Solomon possessed. Here is how the Apostle John refers to the mystery of the mark and how it is all connected to wisdom. Revelation 13 verses 16 to 18, and I read, "It also forced all people, great and small, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on their right hands or on their foreheads, so that they could not buy or sell unless they had the mark, which is the name of the beast or the number of its name. This calls for wisdom. The Antichrist will also come along with a reddish appearance in the same way that the ungodly Esau or Edom, who was a shadow of the Antichrist because of his intense hatred for Israel, also came. The book of Genesis explains that Esau was the first to be born or to be revealed before Jacob was revealed. In the same way, the Antichrist will come first before the real Christ appears. Genesis 25, verses 24 to 25, and I read, "When the time came for her to give birth, there were twin boys in her womb. The first to come out was red, and his whole body was like a hairy garment, so they named him Esau." Just as Esau was born with a red-colored skin, the Antichrist will also come along with a red appearance, similar to that of Satan the dragon, who is his spiritual father. This is why the Antichrist is being compared to a henna stain at its peak, because a blossoming henna stain appears with a deep reddish-brown color, as we read from the Wikipedia quotation. The next passage confirms the devil's red color, which will be the same color as that of the Antichrist when he appears on the world stage. Revelation 12, verse 3, and I read, "Then another sign appeared in heaven, an enormous red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns on its heads." I must make it clear that I am not saying that those who are getting henna tattoos today are receiving the mark of the beast. That is not what I am saying. What I am saying is that the increasing fascination with the henna tattoos is the devil's way of preparing people to receive the mark of the beast when the right time comes. This is because at that time, receiving a henna tattoo will be very normal, very common, and perfectly acceptable, even among dedicated Christians. The devil will therefore use people's acceptance of the henna tattoo for his wicked purposes. My research revealed that the most widespread use of henna is for marriage. I discovered that in some Asian and Middle Eastern cultures, a henna party is held on the day before the wedding. During this pre-wedding party, henna is applied to the hands and feet of the bride-to-be, presumably to mark her journey from childhood to womanhood. As you can see from these practices, the use of henna is all shrouded in magical mystery and superstition. But that is not all. I also discovered that the wedding tradition at times involves the bride secretly including the name of the bridegroom in the henna designs that are placed on her arms. This made me realize that the cluster of henna blossoms, which the woman called her beloved, is actually the mark of the beast, with the name or the number of the beast embedded inside the henna cluster. By receiving the henna tattoo or the mark of the beast upon their bodies, the deceived people will effectively be confirming that they are spiritually married to the devil, even without their conscious knowledge. This is similar to the bride who secretly inscribes the name of the bridegroom on her hand using henna, so that when the henna is eventually removed, the remaining marks on her hands include the name of the new husband, indicating that the woman belongs to the man, just as the deceived people will belong to the Antichrist and the devil. A look at the internet today will show you that henna tattoos are becoming very fashionable among both Christians and non-Christians, as well as among rich and poor. What makes henna tattoos appealing to Christians is that obtaining a tattoo using henna paste does not require one to pierce their skin. Because of this, Christians do not consider it sinful or ungodly to obtain tattoos using henna, as it appears that they are not breaking God's command on the issue of tattoos, which I quote below. Leviticus 19 verse 28, I read from the King James Version. Ye shall not make any cuttings in your flesh for the dead, nor print any marks upon you. I am the Lord. I have quoted from the KJV because there are people who argue that the word tattoo was not in existence at the time the Bible was written. These people point out that the KJV translation of the above passage is more accurate, as it states that believers must not print any marks upon them. This is perfect with my explanation, because what henna paste leaves on the body is exactly what the KJV indicates, which are print marks or tattoos. The henna tattoo movement or wave has gained momentum because of the open support that has come from celebrities who have used henna to place tattoos on their own bodies. Henna tattoos have also gained popularity because the tattoos are not permanent, unlike traditional tattoos that require the piercing of the skin. For those who prefer to have more evidence and supporting scriptures explaining how I arrived at the conclusion that the mark of the beast is a henna tattoo, I will provide the required evidence, beginning with the scripture that gave me the clues to the identity of the mysterious mark. Song of Songs 1 verse 14, and I read, my beloved is to me a cluster of henna blossoms from the vineyards of En-Gedi. The question that stood before me was why the woman who represents the deceived church was describing her beloved man as a cluster of henna flowers that have blossomed. The reason is because the beloved man is the Antichrist, a master of intrigue who comes onto the world stage when wickedness and arrogance have blossomed like a flower, as the next passages indicate. Daniel 8 verse 23, and I read, in the latter part of their reign, when rebels have become completely wicked, a fierce-looking king, a master of intrigue, will arise. Ezekiel 7 verse 10, and I read, see the day, see it comes, doom has burst forth, the rod has budded, arrogance has blossomed. The prophet Ezekiel tells us that towards the end of time, before the return of Christ, the rod of the wicked will bud and their arrogance will blossom like a flower. This is referring to the Old Testament story where some rebellious people rose up against Moses and Aaron, accusing the two of giving themselves too much authority. In order to settle the matter, the Lord commanded each of the 12 tribes of Israel to bring one rod or staff from the leader of their respective tribes, with Aaron representing the Levites, the tribe where both Moses and Aaron came from, and from where all the priests come. What is interesting about this incident is that on each of the 12 rods or staffs, the name of the leader of the tribe was to be written, meaning that the rod or staff effectively became the man whose name it carried. I will quote from the Holy Scriptures. Numbers 17 verses 1 to 5, and I read, "The Lord said to Moses, speak to the Israelites and get 12 staffs from them, one from the leader of each of their ancestral tribes. Write the name of each man on his staff. On the staff of Levi, write Aaron's name, for there must be one staff for the head of each ancestral tribe. Place them in the tent of meeting in front of the Ark of the Covenant Law, where I meet with you. The staff belonging to the men I choose will sprout, and I will rid myself of this constant grumbling against you by the Israelites." Moses told the rebellious people what the Lord had told him, that the staff belonging to the men whom God had chosen would sprout as evidence that God had chosen that particular man. I will quote again from the book of Numbers to show you what happened next. Numbers 17 verses 8 to 9, and I read, "The next day Moses entered the tent and saw that Aaron's staff, which represented the tribe of Levi, had not only sprouted but had budded, blossomed, and produced almonds. Then Moses brought out all the staffs from the Lord's presence to all the Israelites. They looked at them, and each of the leaders took his own staff." As the scripture indicates, the staff or rod of the man whom God had chosen not only sprouted, but budded and blossomed and produced fruit. At that time, none of the rods or staffs of the wicked and rebellious people budded, because God had not chosen any of them and had not given authority to any of the other 11 tribal leaders. I will quote again from the book of Numbers. Numbers 17 verses 10 to 11, and I read, "The Lord said to Moses, put back Aaron's staff in front of the Ark of the Covenant Law to be kept as a sign to the rebellious. This will put an end to their grumbling against me, so that they will not die." Moses did just as the Lord commanded him. The above passage gives useful information on the mark of the beast. The Lord told Moses that the budding, blossoming, and production of fruit by Aaron's staff or rod would be a sign for the rebellious. In simple language, when the time comes for God to choose the leader of the rebellious people, who is the beast or Antichrist, he will give the people a sign to confirm the identity of the Antichrist. And the sign will be that the rod or staff of the Antichrist will also bud and blossom, turning into a henna flower, but without any fruit, unlike the rod of Aaron, which produced almond fruits. This shows that while the wicked Antichrist will also receive authority to lead the people, just like Aaron did, and while the Antichrist will also blossom like a flower, he will produce no fruit for God. This is because the Antichrist is destined to be thrown into the lake of fire, as John the Baptist prophesied concerning the wicked. Luke 3 verse 9, and I read, the axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. The book of Isaiah reveals that the leader of the wicked people, who is the devil and the Antichrist, who is also described as a crown, is a fading flower, confirming that the Antichrist will be represented by a blooming flower which will quickly fade, just like the cluster of henna blooms. I will quote from the prophet Isaiah, Isaiah 28 verse 1, and I read, woe to the crown of pride, to the drunkards of Ephraim, whose glorious beauty is a fading flower, which are on the head of the fat valleys of them that are overcome with wine. Now we have confirmation that the crown of pride, meaning the most proud man, who is the devil and the Antichrist, will be represented by a fading flower placed on the heads of those who are overcome with wine, instead of being filled with the Holy Spirit, a reference to the unbelievers. The fading henna flower is the sign which God will give to the rebellious people of this world to be placed on the foreheads or right hands of those who will regard the arrogant and proud Antichrist as their true Messiah. The book of Proverbs confirms that a rod of pride will be found in the mouth of the foolish. This refers to the fact that all those people who are foolish and who lack the knowledge of God's word will praise and worship the Antichrist, whose name will always be on their lips, instead of praising the name of the one true God. Proverbs 14 verse 3, and I read, in the mouth of the foolish is a rod of pride, but the lips of the wise shall preserve them. The rod of pride, which will bud into a cluster of henna blossoms, is the Antichrist or the beast, who will demand to be worshipped by the whole world. The book of Isaiah also confirms that the Antichrist, whom Isaiah calls the Assyrian, is the rod which God will use to punish the nation of Israel during the Great Tribulation because of the sin of rejecting the true Messiah. Isaiah 10 verses 5 to 7, and I read, woe to the Assyrian, the rod of my anger, in whose hand is the club of my wrath. I send him against a godless nation. I dispatch him against a people who anger me, to seize loot and snatch plunder, and to trample them down like mud in the streets. But this is not what he intends. This is not what he has in mind. His purpose is to destroy, to put an end to many nations. So, God will send the Antichrist to punish the nation of Israel for their godless behavior. But the Antichrist will not be satisfied with just punishing Israel. His desire will be to destroy the nation of Israel and many other nations. This is the man whose arrogance will blossom like a cluster of the henna flower, which is the symbol that will be inscribed on the right hands of the non-believers, so they can buy and sell with the name of the Antichrist inserted inside the henna blossom, which will be tattooed on the right hands or the foreheads of the worshippers of the Antichrist. I will quote again from the Song of Songs. Song of Songs 1 verse 14, and I read, "My beloved is to me a cluster of henna blossoms from the vineyards of Engedi." What the passage shows is that the beloved man who is described in the Song of Solomon will behave like a cluster of henna designs that remain on the skin after the henna has been removed. In other words, the beloved man will come on the world stage with a deep reddish brown color like the henna stain. He will last only a few days before fading away, just like a typical henna stain. And we know the identity of the person who will behave exactly like a henna stain or henna mark, because the book of Revelation has already given us the details of such a man. I will quote directly from the Holy Scriptures. Revelation 17 verse 3, and I read, "Then the angel carried me away in the spirit into a wilderness. There I saw a woman sitting on a scarlet beast that was covered with blasphemous names and had seven heads and ten horns." This is the woman who describes the beloved man as a henna tattoo. So, here we have the description of the beast, also known as the Antichrist, a person who will be fully possessed by the devil. This is the person who will come along with a scarlet or red color, as the book of Revelation shows. The beast will have the same reddish brown color obtained from the use of the henna dye on the skin, as the Song of Songs reveals. This is the man whom the whole world will follow and worship, but who will last only a short while, just like a typical henna tattoo. So, just like Moses, who had a shining face when he came down from the holy mountain, the Antichrist will have a shining and red face when he arrives on the world stage. The artificial glow and brightness of the Antichrist will be destroyed by the glorious appearance of the Lord Jesus, whose glory is much more pronounced and permanent, unlike the glory of the lawless Antichrist, whom the Apostle Paul describes as follows. 2 Thessalonians 2 verse 8, and I read, "And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming." In a future video, I will reveal the number of the beast, because this information is also recorded in the Bible. Such are the mysteries of the God whom we worship.